Let's pray, and then we'll jump right in. Father God, we thank you for this afternoon, and even for little interruptions like fire alarms. We thank you that you interrupt our lives by your grace, and that you interrupt the life of this church at times to redirect us and to point us in the direction you would have us go. And as we have been asking, we continue to ask for unity and clarity and the courage to follow where you lead. We thank you that you brought us this far, and we're excited about where you will take us in the future. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Before I jump in to the presentation part, I want to make a couple of introductions and make sure you know some folks that are here. I presume you do, but it's not always the case. So if you're a member of our executive council, would you stand? You see members that are here. Would you please stand and be recognized? So we have, who else is, let's see, a few of them. Some folks are standing in the back just because they like to stand. Chris Bates in the red in the back there. That's Chris, is our executive counselor. Frank Valentini, who's standing guard by Chris. Scott Salvati. Rick, were you applauding for Scott? We can applaud for Scott. Rick Bloom over here. Russ Crucial. Anybody else we're missing that I'm not naming who's here? Okay. Good. You can get online if you don't know. Sometimes in a church our size with multiple services and venues, you don't always know who the EC members are. There are others that are not here that are on our executive council. I encourage you to get online and pray for them. And if you have questions that I don't answer or we don't answer today, you can certainly seek them out as well. Is Dave? Cindy's here as like a proxy for Dave. He's our church chairman, yeah. Okay. Less than 3 months ago, seems like a long time to me, but less than 3 months ago, we had a pretty historic church family meeting. How many of you were present at our meeting in August? Show of hands. At that meeting, we voted overwhelmingly to approve a merger with Faith Baptist Mill Creek. We voted on a senior pastor transition, which has happened. It seems. Somebody asked me the other day, how were your first 60 days? And I went, wow, I don't know. It feels like it's a blink, you know. We voted on approval of a plan, the general outline of a plan, to raise the funds to expand all three of our facilities and improve them for the sake of our gospel growth. I think all of this, that meeting and all that's happened since, are really evidence of God continuing to lead us in an exciting new direction as a church. So as you heard several times, what I want to talk about is what has happened, what's going on right now, and then most of the time on what's to come. A tremendous amount of work has taken place in those 3 months. We have welcomed Faith Baptist Mill Creek into our church family. Some of them are here. I see Brian Gamblin in the back there. I see some of those folks that are here. In fact, if you're part of the Faith Baptist community that's now part of our church family, would you also stand so we could just recognize you? Thank you. Hey, thank you. I recall at one of our meetings, Pastor Brian saying, we need to think of this as two streams becoming one larger river for the glory of God. We would just put a pause, and things move so fast, it's good to pause and say, thank you to God. But that has happened and is happening, and we're excited about where that will go. We have, since that time, we have completed that merger, as I mentioned. We've worked diligently to finalize construction plans and costs, and that's still going on. We've met with a consultant in the multi-site church area to develop our launch plans and begin to develop them. And again, there's more of that to come. We've put together the vision and plans for raising the funds, which you'll hear about in a few moments. So in 3 months, there's been a tremendous amount of work by a lot of really competent and prayerful and thoughtful people. You'll see on the screen here an image of the strategic timeline. Oop, there it is. You already had it up there. I didn't even know. This is a very simplified version. We have detailed timelines on each one of these areas for those of us that are working hard on these things. But just to give you a sense of things as we look forward, we had the annual meeting in August. Welcome Faith Baptist. You completed the merger. We'll begin construction at Mill Creek in December. We'll talk more about that in a minute. We're looking toward a vision weekend on January 8th. We've never really done this since I've been here. We've done smaller examples of it, but on that weekend, we're trying to simulcast across all of our campuses one message. We're all receiving the same message at the same time. It's sort of a state of the union, where we are and where we're headed as a church for that weekend. Very excited about that. You can pray for that. We've got a lot of work to do to prepare for that. We'll begin the Neighborhood Impact Campaign. We'll talk about that in a few moments, and then you see where construction begins at West and so forth. So these are just sort of the major chunks of things that are going on as we move forward. As I said, we have detailed and separate timelines for each of these areas, and there are a lot of people praying and working hard to keep all these things on track. In fact, many of you have been and continue to faithfully pray for us and as we move forward on these things. I just want to say thank you. Keep at it. Keep praying. Join us in prayer. To seek God for his direction, for his vision, and for his provision. None of these things on this timeline amount to anything if God's not behind it and not in it. So I just want to say thanks to those of you who have committed to pray and call all of us to continue to pray together and individually as we move forward. And I think before we get to the specifics of some of these areas, we need to pause and revisit the big reason why. In fact, when Brian was on sabbatical and after the official transition, I had sort of a panic attack. Not a panic attack. Those of you that have had actual panic attacks, it was mild. But I had this moment where I thought, what are we doing? This is foolish. I'm brand new in this role. We're taking on too much. Let's just pull everything back, you know? What God did for me was to bring my heart back to why. Because it can. I bet in your own life it feels this way. So many things going on, swirling around at one time. You need to sort of recenter and refocus on why are we doing this? What's behind this? If we don't get that right, we'll get a whole bunch of other things wrong as well. So you'll see the vision statement here. I think it was up there a moment ago. This has been our vision statement for a while now. There it is. We're moving toward becoming a family of neighborhood churches that are committed to transforming lives to impact the world with the gospel of Jesus Christ. We already are this to a degree, but this is where we think God is taking us. Now, there's a lot of explanation and definition that needs to happen around that, but that's the sort of the overarching why. As we said before, if we're going to grow in our gospel impact as a church, we've said for years, reaching, connecting, equipping, and serving people, moving them closer and closer toward being sold out for Christ. If we're going to continue to see God grow our gospel impact, reach, connect, equip, and serve more people for the sake of his kingdom, then what's the most effective way to do that? What's it going to look like? And what's the most effective way for us as a church to do that? Is it to build a bigger box here and hope that more and more people drive from farther and farther away to our big box? We're convinced the answer to that question is no. That's not the most effective way for us to continue to make a growing gospel impact. So we believe it's to multiply ourselves, to reproduce ourselves, to plant ourselves in neighborhood churches that share sort of the center of who we are, but have freedom to express the gospel ministry in their own way in their regions. And the first one we're looking at, as you know, is the third campus at Mill Creek. We think that God's brought us to that point. You're going to see here on the screen a map of Kane County. In this map, I want you to think about this. So you'll see the Kane County image come up here next, if it does. Oh, no, first you see our three campuses. That's us. Now you'll see Kane County here on the screen. Think about this. That's where God's placed us. We're not trying to be a multi-site church all over Chicagoland or all over the Midwest. We're in a particular region of a particular part of the world at a particular time. This is our neighborhood, if you will, on the macro level. And actually, our reach extends maybe not quite that far west, but a little further east. So I had them redraw this map. That's about our neighborhood. Think about that gray box as our neighborhood as a church. That's where God's put us. You live in that box for a reason. I live in that box for a reason. Our church is in that box for a reason. To make an impact. To see life transformation and gospel impact happen in where God has placed us. By the way, we did some digging. This is 2010 census data, so it's at least more. 600,000 people, more than, living in that box. More than 500,000 people live in that gray box. And in 2010, 49.8% of them identified as having no church affiliation at all. So it's at least 50% now. So let's just say roughly 300,000 people in that box, in our neighborhood, have no church affiliation at all. That's the low estimate. This is why, friends. We could just kind of coast and be two campuses in a nice suburban church with we like each other and there's good worship and this preaching is better than average and, you know, and we just kind of sail off and do our thing. That's not why. I didn't sign up for that. I know our staff and leadership hasn't signed up for that, and I hope you haven't either. We're here to make an impact. How are we going to do that? So I just wanted to come back and recenter before we get into all the details about why are we doing this? Now more than ever, the church needs to be an organization, a movement, making an impact in our culture, not huddling up and hanging on, but reaching people. And it's going to be harder than ever, but more exciting than ever, I think, as well. Think about that for a minute. 300,000 people, 50%. That means, statistically speaking, every other person you meet doesn't have a church, doesn't want a church, doesn't know. Let that settle for a minute. Every other person you interact with, on a statistical level, not necessarily, I mean, unless you just live in your own little Christian bubble and don't talk to other people, that's pretty remarkable and pretty sobering and exciting. We tend to think of, I think, Chicago suburbs and Geneva, Kane County, Tri-Cities as like, well, it's a pretty churched place. Not so anymore. Not so. This is our compelling why, and it's critical for us to keep this clear in our minds and our hearts as we get further and further into the numbers and the buildings and the details of the plan. From the beginning, we first started talking about this possibility. I invited you to pray for unity, clarity, and courage. And we have continually, I have seen, and many of us have seen, God answer this prayer, clarifying his vision, unifying us around this why, and giving us the courage to take the next step. We wouldn't be having this meeting if he hadn't been answering those prayers. Speaking of that next step, many of you are wondering, I'm sure, and you came to this meeting hoping to hear about, well, okay, let's talk about this third campus. What is the plan? How are we going to do this? What's it going to look like? And when and how and all of that. Many of those answers, I want to prepare you ahead of time, are still being worked out. We aren't going to be able to share all of the nitty-gritty details about that plan with you today, but we can share in general terms where we're headed, and we hope that's will generate excitement for you. You'll see here on the screen, is it already up there? You're way ahead of me. I should not even ask. This sort of target gives you an idea. Some of you asked about who's going to go, how are we going to select them. Let me talk about that at a high level. The center of the circle is our staff team, and we'll leave that for last. Moving out one circle, it's green on my screen, it's blue on yours, is the core team. The core team would be the early adapters, those who live in or near Mill Creek or in that region, who very early on say, I want to be part of this, I want to reach my neighbor for Christ, I'm in, I'm sold out to this vision. And we're looking for 30, give or take, 30 to 40 people to be in that core team, to begin early on in 2017 to pray and to plan and to meet together. The next circle out is what we're calling our launch team. That includes all of the people and staff and core who decide, yes, we're going to go. We're preferably looking for that number to be 200, including adults and children. 200 to start. Now, on day one, through word of mouth and communication, it may be a big opening day, but 200 as a sort of the launch team, we're going to worship there and commit themselves to reaching their neighbors and making that their home. Now, you're probably wondering, but what about the staff? I haven't mentioned the staff, you know, specifically yet. We think through working with consultants and in our own thinking internally that we know we're going to need a full-time campus pastor. We know we're going to need people committed to leading worship on staff, vibrant worship. We know we're going to need some staff members or member to oversee quality children's ministries. We know that much to begin with. So we're saying, you know, 3 to 4 staff members to begin with. We have identified one of those 3 to 4 with certainty, and I just want to take this opportunity to introduce to you our campus pastor for the Mill Creek campus, Sterling Moore. We have a mic. We have a microphone. Sterling is, as you know, Sterling's been here over a decade now. Isn't that right, Sterling?
Yeah, just about 10 years.
About 10 years. And we were thinking, before this vision ever came clear, that we were going to move Sterling into a family pastor role, getting him a couple of levels removed from his role as high school pastor. And he's been a student ministries pastor. And God redirected our hearts and his heart at the same time, as he has done in my life in the past and in Brian's life and so many times. And I'm excited about that. And so I just wanted to invite him up here to say a few words.
Yeah, I just, my wife and I, as we've been praying about this and thinking about this opportunity, we are humbled and excited that God has led in our lives in this direction. And Jeff has often talked about like the trajectory that FBCG and Pastor Brian and his leadership has played in his life. And the opportunity to see that unfold in my life as well, as I came as the high school pastor 10 years ago and given opportunities to preach and teach in our services and to grow in that, to be given opportunities in leadership, allowed to make mistakes at times, but encouraged.
When were those?
Early on, very early. Then it's been smooth sailing since. But just absolutely encouraged and excited, and really God moving and working in my heart, my wife's heart, for the opportunity, the harvest field that is just 10 to 15 minutes south of here. God has been breaking our hearts for the people of this community, of the opportunity that exists for the gospel to go forward. I'm wholeheartedly committed to the vision that Pastor Jeff and Pastor Brian have laid out in front of us over these last several months. I believe in it, and I am just looking forward to everything that he has in store for us, the exciting opportunities to see his kingdom advance, ministry impact continue. And I'm humbled by the opportunity to be a part of this, so thank you.
Thank you. You know, I would say this in his absence, and I'll certainly say it in his presence, and I certainly alluded to this. First of all, let me say to all of you, to FBCG, thank you for being a place where young leaders can grow up in their gifts and not have to leave and have new opportunities. Thank you for that. It's happened in Brian's life, it's happened in my life, and I praise God to see it happening in Sterling's life. He's exactly the right guy. None of us saw that 10 years ago when you came here to oversee Trek and student ministries, and now take this on. So he's exactly the right guy. Maybe I'm saying it as much for Sherry as for you, but he's the right guy. You already know that. Recently, a friend in leadership asked me this question. Are you, related to the third campus, he said, are you at all concerned that some of the best leaders will be taken to go there with them? Now, while I understand that sentiment, and I understand that concern to a degree, I want you to hear me say that's exactly the wrong way to think and talk about this. Because that's not them. This is all us. We lose no one. We only gain. And it's very important that we think that way. We're not sending some of us to go over there with them and do their thing. This is God growing us, growing our impact. And so we're not losing anybody. We're multiplying, and we're reproducing and growing. It's not a zero-sum game, in other words. Every time that sort of thing has happened with campuses or in budgets, God has done more than we could have ever imagined, and we trust him to do that again. Now, having said that, there will be some of you that are probably already thinking, I think I want to be in on this. I'm thinking I might be one of those 30 or 40. Those of you who would be early adapters in that core team must absolutely be committed to the vision of, in other words, if you're thinking, hey, I'd like to worship in a smaller venue and just have a smaller group, don't go there, because that's the wrong kind of thinking, right? There's nothing wrong with a smaller venue, but we're trying to reach people. We're trying to grow our impact as a church in this region, in our neighborhood. Remember, keep that box in mind. So some of you are already thinking and praying about it. By introducing Sterling, the door is now open. There are no secrets. You can email him, you can call him, or me, or Brian, or any of us, and ask questions and start to find out if this is what God might stir your heart to do. And of course, when we get into the new year, more formally, we'll talk about how to get involved in that, and there'll be events and things to attend. But for now, you know, we're sort of saying, hey, if that's on your heart, start talking and praying about that as soon as you like. We all need to be asking ourselves the question, how engaged am I in the lives of my neighbors? So this is very important. This is one of the key messages from today I hope you take away. This is not doing neighborhood church over there. This is reimagining who we are as a community of faith. Every one of us needs to be asking the question, how engaged am I in the life of my neighbors? Next door, down the street, that I work next to, my neighbors at work, my neighbors in the carpool, my neighbors at school. How engaged are you in their lives? What impact am I having in the lives that I live near and work near? Because we want to be a church not just for ourselves, but for our neighbors in our neighborhood. And in many ways, FBCG has always been this. We're just making it more explicit now. We're just putting it right out front and saying this is who we are. So when we talk about launching our third campus at the Mill Creek site, we know that there are five things we have to do really well on day one. And by the way, this week and the week following, we're going to be diving deep with our staff department heads into how each ministry will be reflected across the campuses, so we don't have a lot of answers. But we know on day one, when we open, we need to have quality preaching, like we do hopefully at all of our campuses, and it'll be predominantly live preaching, vibrant worship. Our worship has to be vibrant, lifting high the name of Jesus and engaging people. Have excellent children's ministries. This is in the center of where families live. We need to care for their kids and care for them well. They need to feel safe and excited about being there. In fact, I talked to somebody on our staff recently who said that they chose to come here before our staff just to worship here because it was the right place for their children. And, you know, we want to have, the fourth thing is then people in community, in book clubs, neighborhood groups. That's been a growing part of who we are over the past 3 years. We want to see that continue to grow and be sort of central to the DNA of the neighborhood church. People reading God's word in homes together, inviting their neighbors, and discussing what the word of God means in their own contexts. And then the fifth thing would be what we call guest services. That when people walk in the door, looking around, I don't know anybody, that they feel welcomed, they understand where to go, who to talk to about their questions. And so we're working hard to have those five things dialed in on day one, and then of course a lot of things behind that as we grow. This brings us to the question of how are we going to pay for all this? How are we going to fund all of this? First, let me back up a bit and remind us all where we've been. In 2013, we launched Growing to Serve. Many of you were here for that. There were four components of that. There was eliminate our existing debt. There was a remodel of the East Campus. And there was a twofold expansion to our West Campus, to the north, which we did, and to the south. You remember the line that used to be painted out there. We raised enough money. That was a $9 million number, give or take, and we raised enough money to do three of those four things. By God's grace and your generosity, we paid off our debt, we remodeled the east, and we expanded to the north. And we left off the fourth part. Since that time, God has redirected our thinking, as we've been talking about. And he's done this, by the way, multiple times in our history, in the past, with the purchase of the property here, with what we ended up building here initially, with the 2008 market crash and rethinking about, let's not build the giant 2,000-seat thing out here. God has done this. And I said this in this sermon, this you'll hear it next week if you're at West, about God's gracious interruptions. I think he's done that for us multiple times, and I see it here now. So what this means is, when we launch into what we're going to call neighborhood impact, the campaign to raise the $6.2 million for all of it, and I'll talk about that in detail in a moment, we should not think of this as just finishing what we started with Growing to Serve. Because he's redirected our focus and our direction and our vision as a church. It's a new initiative to strategically multiply ourselves through gospel-driven neighborhood churches. Not what we envisioned when we launched Growing to Serve. And I praise him for that. But it's important that we keep that in mind. Now, we are going to address some of the things that were left on the table, two of which were nursery space and lobby redesign. Without adding to the footprint here, we are going to expand the nurseries back there and redesign our lobby that will be more effective for flow at the West Campus. And you'll see here some images now of some of the plans. By the way, this was all in the material handed out at our annual meeting and in our meeting back in July. But just for review, a couple of the images, you'll see some Mill Creek images. This is the exterior artist's drawings of what the Mill Creek building would look like. Now, the first one on the left there is looking, I guess I would be standing at the southwest corner looking at the new sanctuary to build. And that's two different angles of that building. And there's a lot more drawings you in the information we handed out, and certainly more to come. The next image shows what will happen in this room, the West Gym. It won't be quite that dark, but that's just part of the way it renders on the screen. Oh, that John, that's so nice and so tiny. It's like, hide the water bottle, do you see? Anyway, since we're not going to build a 2,000-seat worship center here, we don't think that's the right use of funds. It would strap us with a lot of debt and be not very functional in multi-use space. We never intended to worship in a gym long-term. God, we've been able to do that effectively, but we think if this is where we're going, let's make this the best worship space it can be. while still maintaining multiple use. So we'll lose basketball and volleyball, but we won't lose Moms Together or Team or any of the multifunction of the space. It'll just be a better room for worship. So that's on part of the plan as well. And those are just to review. So the plans also include East expansion for Shepherd's Heart. By the way, we've talked about different numbers, but Aaron Wise told us last week that Shepherd's Heart has been averaging 1,000 individuals a month. It's remarkable what's happening there. Just come by some afternoon and see the families that are being ministered to, or some Wednesday evening and see the families that are receiving care and encouragement through Shepherd's Heart. So that's very exciting. We're going to also move hand-in-hand preschool from the East Campus to Mill Creek. And in case you're wondering how Nancy Taylor, the preschool director, feels about that, is she here? I don't think she's here. She's thrilled about it. She's excited about that. We're going to move that out there. We think it's a good strategic move to reach families. We're going to expand the nursery and lobby. I mentioned that. And all of these things that we presented back in July, this is just review for those of you that have been here, all these things come to $5.7 million. When you add the $500,000 of debt that we acquired with Mill Creek, that puts us at 6.2. That's the Neighborhood Impact sort of initiative, to raise that money to do those things. None of it's frivolous. None of it's over the top. We think it's all necessary. It addresses all three campuses, because we're not just only, this isn't only about a new third campus. It's about us expanding our ability to make gospel impact as a church. We will begin ramping up the Neighborhood Impact campaign in January of 2017. We'll talk about it more. We'll point to it more. I mentioned the vision night on January 8th, or vision morning, excuse me. But this will culminate in a 4 to 5 week public campaign beginning in middle February, where we'll sort of, it'll be all hands on deck. It'll be what we're doing as a church. We talk about it, celebrate it, and push toward, like we did last time, celebration day, where we give our first fruits of our pledges and gifts, and we see what God provides for us, and we move forward. Again, you'll see the strategic timeline image representing when those things will happen in general terms. So I feel like I should drink this, since John was so graciously brought up here. As you can see, we're planning and moving forward with all these exciting initiatives. This is all happening behind the scenes. Years ago, a guy, when I was when I transitioned out of youth ministry to be whatever I was prior, Brian's number two, you know, preaching and teaching. And a friend of mine asked me, "So will you be full time now?" You know, people think, you know, what do? With the church, you read your Bible, you take a nap, you prepare a sermon. You know, I don't know. So there's a tremendous amount going on behind the scenes, and we're excited about it. But it's we're being stretched in a good way as a staff and as leadership. We've already begun to see God moving in the hearts and minds of people toward generosity. So in fact, a couple of people have already approached us and said, "Hey, listen, we know the campaign's coming in 2017, but could we give to it this year, 2016?" Yes. Yes, let me think about that for a minute. Yes, absolutely. So that's if for tax reasons, or if God's moving in your heart, that's something that you would want to do, absolutely you can. My wife and I, we're going to, before the year's out, make a first contribution in 2016. So you certainly can do that, and we would encourage that. But in 2017, we'll roll it out publicly, is all I'm saying there. Whew. So there's one other issue that I'm excited to talk to you about, and we need to talk about and address before we open it up for questions. Now, that is the issue of our church name, specifically whether or not we should change it. Pregnant pause. What is clear is that if we're ever going to change our name, if we ever are going to do this, this is the perfect time to talk about it and think about it. Now is the time to do that. Personally, just, you know, since we're going to be right up front here, personally, I think this is the right time, and we must do it. Our name is often our first opportunity to cast vision about who we are, our first chance to communicate something about who we are. And we've talked about this at length. It's been in print and in other church family meetings, that there are some barriers in our name. I talked with a staff member just this past week, and I just said, "Let me get your read on the church name change." And her response was, "Please do, yes. In fact, it was a huge barrier for me to even coming here, just because Baptist just was like, nope, no thank you." But now she works on our staff, so ha ha. Right? But I think about that. That's indicative of so many people that many of us have talked to, perhaps many of you even as well. Recently, I read an article that talked about the six primary reasons why you change a church name. Let me tick through those just in brief terms. Number one, to create a clear or new priority. I think that would fit us. Number two, when the scope of a church's ministry goes beyond the name that is geographically limited. That's certainly true. We're not just Geneva, and we won't be as we expand. Number three, when a name is a barrier to the people that a church is trying to reach. That's absolutely true. It has been for a long time. When the name, number four, re-clarifies the church's identity during a relaunch or an organizational rite of passage or a new strategic direction. Yeah, I think we qualify there. Number five, when a name streamlines communication by shortening or modifying to reflect common usage. Maybe. And number six, when an original name works against building awareness. Now, this is the one thing that perhaps we don't qualify for. I think people who know us in our community, FBCG, think well of us by and large. But we're talking about those who don't yet know us. I know that for some of you, this will be an emotionally charged thing to even talk about. I just want to urge you to reflect back on. In fact, bring that neighborhood screen back up if we can. Just go backwards. I'll challenge your skills up there. I want you to think about 300,000 people who don't know us, for whom the name Baptist or First or Geneva even are a barrier, who don't know about the gospel we teach here, who haven't experienced the warmth of your welcome and fellowship and our worship and that, and why would we put anything unnecessarily in the way of that? Most of all, who don't know the gospel of Jesus Christ, the message that there's a God who loves them, who died for them, and wants to redeem their lives and bring them into his family. Now let me make some things clear before we talk any further about this. I am, and we are, absolutely proud of our heritage and our affiliation as a Baptist, part of the Baptist General Conference, now called Converge Worldwide. That should be a hint to you. We will not compromise our commitments to Christ, to his gospel, and to the truth of the Word of God. We remain and will remain part of Converge Worldwide, Baptist General Conference formerly. We will most likely remain, should we change the name, and we haven't decided to, but I just wanted to be frank with you, upfront about my desire and our desire as leadership. Should we change the name, we would most likely remain incorporated as FBCG, First Baptist Church of Geneva, simply changing our doing business as name, the name by which we're known. Number four, it's critical that our new name, should we choose one, be aligned as much as possible with our vision and mission as a church, and not be an unnecessary barrier to reaching people. Lastly, let me just say, we don't want to make this decision hastily or lightly. We've been talking about it and praying about it for a number of years now, but more specifically and more in depth in recent months. So we don't want to make this hastily or lightly. For this reason, we want to invite you and our church family to speak into this decision, to have a place to give your voice, not just in this meeting, but in an ongoing way, because you might have thoughts that occur to you in the weeks and months following. We're not going to be taking a vote and just take the most popular name. That might be the way to elect a president, but it's not the way to define a church name. That was a bad joke. It was funny in my head. Anyway, so we're not going to take a vote, but we do want you to solicit your feedback. So should you have an idea for a church name? Should you have an idea for how to shape it or a direction? Or should you have concerns you want to voice? You can go to our website, and you'll see here how to do that on the church on the screen, fbcg.com, name change. There's a page on our website for this with some information that I've already spoken to you about and some more resources to read there. And you can click a button there, and it'll take you to this page. I don't know if it'll do that or not. We don't have that. Nope, probably just that page. It takes you to a page where you can make a name change submission, or a name suggestion for a new name, and a place for comments. We'll field that. We'll pray about that. We'll read through all of that. We're going to leave that open on our website between now and the end of 2016 for you to do that. Our intent would be to take our thinking as leadership on this and the submissions and suggestions and comments and input from you, the congregation, and prayerfully pursue establishing a new name by hopefully Easter 2017. I say hopefully because We don't know where God will lead. We want to be open to this. This would allow us the time, should we choose to do this, to develop all the resources to communicate. There's a lot that would have to go into making this known in the community as we launch. It would allow us the time to do this in preparation for the third campus, before the launch of the Mill Creek campus. But you know, we'll stop there. There's more to say about that, but we'll leave that off for now. So we've covered a lot of ground here, and there are a lot of interconnected things happening at the same time. I hope you get appreciation for that. At times, as I said, I have moments of anxiety, like, what are we doing? But increasingly, I have less of those and more of an affirmation in my spirit that this is exactly the right time and where God is taking us and leading us as a church. I sense God affirming it. I sense it in my own life and in the conversations with many of you that he's unifying us around this vision to reach and to serve our neighbors. He's sort of clarifying or honing the tip of the spear for us. Like, think of it that way. We're put here for a purpose. You are, as an individual Christ follower. We are, as this part of his body, been placed here to make an impact. And I really feel increasingly affirmed that God is saying, just take the next step. Just take the next step as a church. Trust me. Trust me with what's going to happen and take the next step. No doubt, as the vision statement comes back up here, just to remind you again, we've got a lot of work ahead of us. And all of us, staff, leadership on the EC, and all of you, we'll be challenged. We'll be stretched. We'll be made uncomfortable in different ways in this process. It's already happening for many of us. Perhaps some of you feel that now. That's a good thing. That's a really good thing. It's a sign of his growth. It's not good for us to be comfortable all the time. What else would you rather be doing? What else would you rather be doing? Do you just want to go to a sleepy little suburban church that makes you feel good about yourself? Rather than giving our lives to make an impact in our neighborhood, in the world, where God's placed us. So with all that said, here endeth the official public remarks. I'd like to bring Brian up, and the EC members will be here as well. You could ask any of us, Sterling included, a question about anything we've talked about. If you need to go, if you have sitters or something that want to go now, you can do that, but we're going to open it up now for questions. So here, Dave, you want to grab this one? In case. Well, you need a mic, don't you? Do you need a mic? Oh, there's another one. There's a mic. Okay. So questions. And please raise your hand so we can get these recorded, because we're recording the whole session today. So we can get these on mic. Questions? Comments? Silly stories? Anecdotes? Well, let's go Bill and then you. So we got one over here. Is there another mic? No. Okay.
I was just wondering if you and Brian are going to be the kind of the leaders of this, all the things that are going to happen in the next 8 months, or is somebody else away from, you know, I think about the scripture saying that we should spend more time in reading and praying. It's like among one out of your number, yeah, to lead and direct. I'm just wondering if it will take, it's going to take a lot of time. And so I'm just wondering if you are going to take that responsibility.
Thank you, Bill. That very question was asked this past Thursday at our executive council meeting by one of our EC members, looking not just at that timeline, but at like five pages of detailed timelines. One of our EC members, in fact, Chris Bates, actually, he said, this is a lot. And he was worried that it would be too much for me. It absolutely would be. So I want to be. I appreciate you saying that, and I should have made this clearer earlier. There are a number of really qualified, competent people on our staff. Primarily, Doug Kite on the financial side is carrying the lion's share of this. So I don't want to give the impression that I'm doing all this. I think my unique role is sort of continually casting vision and reminding us of why. But I'm not in all the. I'm not the decision maker at every point. So that's a really good question. Anything to add to that, Brian or Doug?
Oh, yeah. Okay. Let me pass it.
Let Pastor Bob go ahead.
Like Jeff said, it is a good question. And with the strength of our leadership right now, I think, is that we lead as a team. Our senior leadership team is Jeff, Doug Kite, myself, Bruce McAvoy, Sterling Moore is sitting in there because he's going to the Mill Creek campus in a year. So the five of us meet every week, and then that's we're surrounded by a very high quality of department leaders, full-time people who lead ministry departments, and then there's another ring of staff behind, beyond that. So we share the responsibility. Jeff is going to be the visionary lead voice of our church family. I'm here to support him in any way I can, and to where I can step in, or where I can share my wisdom or skills or experience, I will do that. But Jeff's the lead voice, and we all serve this vision, so we'll do it together.
Oh, you're dead.
I was just going to say, in case you were wondering about some of us old timers, I say change the name.
Some of you may not know who that particular old timer is, but that's Bob Gray. Bob was pastor here for how many years? 15 years, and was here when I got here in 1986 and helped me get my feet wet in ministry, and was one of my mentors, and Bob is back. He's only 275 years old, but he's here. I'm just kidding. Bob is one of my dear friends and has been around this church since long before I was. So thanks, Bob.
Thank you for saying that. Other questions or comments?
You also mentioned that the preaching will be live rather than on TV. Didn't you mention that?
I did. Go ahead.
So that means that Sterling will be in rotation, so he will be not only speaking at Mill Creek, but he might be speaking at East and West too?
Yes. While the details of how that's all going to work, like the schematic for how that will work, we're still working on that. But part of Sterling preaching so much this fall is not only because Brian's on sabbatical, he's been back for a while, it's in preparing Sterling, and I think we've all been very blessed by his teaching of God's word, and he's growing tremendously. And Andrew Griffiths, Andrew's here somewhere back there, if you've heard him preach. So we're developing and continue to develop a teaching and preaching team. That would be our desire to continue to share that. And so we would be predominantly live. I think we need to develop the capability at strategic times to do video so for our church family, but we would want to be predominantly live preaching, which would mean I don't want to be tied down on this because we're working on it, but Sterling would preach, say, if he preaches three times a month, two of them would be at Mill Creek. So he would be there more than other places. But yes, we envision sharing and rotating somewhat. Other comments or questions? Really not? This is, make them up.
So if this is going to be like an auditorium in here, and you said the moms connected and moms together still, how will that
so
work?
So not fixed seating. So the chairs will still be stacked and moved away.
Oh, they will. Yeah.
Still okay. Be an open flat floor. Yeah. So the floor won't be sloped. The chairs won't be fixed. We can still move the chairs out of the way. You just won't have a gym floor and a big gym ceiling. The lighting, the sound, and the feel of the room will be much more conducive to worship than to sports.
Actually, much more conducive to what women's ministry tries to do in those kinds of ministries. The environment will feel, I think, if we do what we're planning on doing, it'll feel very, very good for those kind of gatherings.
That's a good question, because I think people envision, like, well, then there's just the flip-up chairs that are fixed and we can't do anything. And that's not, we still want to use this during the week.
Not a question, but it's rather a good sign that there aren't too many questions around it. It feels like just a sense that everybody is very on board with all this, and well, they trust you, trust our leaders here at this church. So I want to encourage you guys.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Did your mom tell you to say that? Thank you. I know. Thank you.
Hey, Bill, this is the third one. After this, you really have to stop. No, I'm just kidding.
No, he doesn't. He said that.
Will the Mill Creek staff have a youth director for teenagers and that kind?
Good question. Very good question. That gets to the larger issue of how are we going to represent our different ministries across three campuses. One of the benefits of Mill Creek not being like in five towns away is that we don't have to reproduce everything there. So we don't think it will have a separate youth ministry. We think it will be part of the youth ministry for all three campuses. That doesn't mean there won't be trained leaders and that would be overseeing the groups from the families that are part of that campus. But we don't envision a separate reproducing all those things there. Shirley, anything more to add to that? Yeah. Oh, so yes.
My question has partly been answered. I was wondering if other staff members are going to move to work mostly in the Mill Creek area.
Yes. Well, it's a very good question. Some. We would love for the staff members that go there to be people that have kind of grown up on our staff now, to not have to go outside to find them. And we think that's probably going to be true. We haven't nailed them all down yet, except for Sterling. But this is a good opportunity to say this. Over here to my right is Eric Robertson and his lovely wife, Julie. You heard them lead worship here at the West Campus. They'll be here first of the year on staff. And so just say thank you to them. Part of bringing Eric on staff is not only his ability to lead worship on stage, his knowledge of production and technology and sound, but is to strengthen our worship staff so that somebody from perhaps could go. Because right now we're spread pretty thin, and so it'll be hard to just send. So that's part of growing our staff is for that reason. So yes, answer to your question is that some of our staff members will likely be going over there to join Sterling. But we haven't identified exactly who those all are yet.
Will the new campus affect the service offerings at the existing campuses, like the number of services, the worship cafe, word and table, anything like that?
Whoa. If I understand your question right, will the new campus affect what exists already?
Worship cafe, maybe.
Yeah, I think the only one it might would be worship cafe. If, for example, a large number of those families wanted to go and be part of Mill Creek, we would have to reevaluate what we do with Worship Cafe going forward. But there's no plan to shut things down like Word and Table or anything like that. And so I think we would only want to grow our services. Yeah. You see Tim here?
I am.
Scott's coming from behind you.
So this is obviously a huge undertaking for you guys and for the church. Are there things on your heart that we can be praying for you for?
Tim, I can't tell you how much it means to me that you'd ask that question. Thank you.
I'm trying to, all of it in a way, you know. I'm trying to think of where to begin. I once heard I forgot his name now, who said that, like a mosquito in a nudist colony, I'm trying to decide where to begin.
He just said that.
Yeah, that's... You know, in addition to praying for God's provision for all this, because it does feel like we're taking on a lot here at times, I guess I would pray. I think it's at times when we're trying, I would put it this way. I feel as if, as a church, when we're trying to be out there where God wants us to be, that's the most exciting, and we can be the most vulnerable to the enemy's attack. So I would just ask you to pray against division. In my own heart, I've noticed a tendency at times in me to get like hyper-focused on, we got to do this, and bringing people together, that we'd be unified, not divided, that God would bring us together through this. It would grieve me if we get to the end of the road and we've raised the money and built the buildings, but there's casualties because we didn't love each other and we weren't unified along the way. So that's, I'd ask you to pray for that. Would you add to that?
Yeah, it's a great question. I can maybe speak to this from the chair I sit in now. I would ask you to pray for Jeff first and foremost. There's a lot of stress that comes with that chair because you start to worry about everything. And you don't have to, but you do. He's got a great team around him. We're all around him. Everybody's around him. But let him know that. I can tell you just an email that says, hey, I prayed for you today, Jeff, or a little note, hey, our family's praying for you. Those are incredibly encouraging and powerful. this will sound funny, but send him a gift card every now and then so he has to take his wife out for dinner. Because to control his stress level, he has to have invested time with his in his marriage and with his family. And he's already learning in the first 60 days how to manage a new kind of thinking, a new kind of calendar, to still preach the word with all the passion he's always had, but to do all this other stuff. And pray for the rest of us to see what we can do to help him, and pray for all the team, and pray for our church family. So I can say it now, is let him know. Because it means a great deal to know you being prayed for. Let Sterling know. And we know you do, but when you let us know, it's very, very powerful. So thank you.
And if you're going to give a gift card, I would... No. in all seriousness, I don't want this to be like, pray for me because this is my thing. I mean, I so appreciate that. And it does mean a great deal to know, to hear those encouragements. But pray for our staff too, because we're all going to be asked and stretched to think bigger than our little ministry area. I think outside of ourselves. And so we have, our staff team is just tremendous. So I thank God for them, but pray for them as well. In the back.
Hi, so can you I think I misheard with the name change. When is that website going to go down? I thought I heard in 2016, at the end of this year, and then what's the timeline for the name change?
Okay, timeline for the name change, and how long will the website be up for suggestions? We're going to leave that page active throughout for the rest of 2016, month and a half, two or so. That doesn't mean you can't send an email with your thoughts beyond that after that, but that's when we're going to leave it active for. So we're going to talk about that and mention that. I can't tell you definitively when or if we'll change our name. I just wanted to use this opportunity to say we think we should, and we want to start the ball rolling on that process. Our hope is that God would bless this process and clarify us around the new name, and we could reveal that and roll that out prior to Easter of 2017. But I really prayed a lot about this and thought, is this the right time to throw this extra thing on at the end of all the other stuff we're talking about? Talked with the executive council and our staff, and we all said, yeah, this is the right time. So I just wanted to say it publicly on the record, we should do this and see where God takes it.
I'd like to comment, first of all, that we are in favor of a name change.
You could be in charge if you want to be in charge.
Thanks, but we're busy. Which we're so not. The other thing is just a suggestion. My very, very favorite prayer in all of Scripture is in Colossians 1, 9 through 12. And I could only just say the first part without looking at it, but that we would be filled with the knowledge of God's will with all spiritual insight and understanding.
Thank you.
And then it goes on from there. But it's just a fabulous prayer for God's direction.
Thank you, ma'am.
Colossians 1, 9 through 12. You can write it down.
Adrian. To race.
Just coming back to the question about the high school ministries and regarding the different locations and having a single ministry. My question is that it seems to have proven difficult in the past, at least for having just gone through the middle age where my kids were in the high school program, of worshiping together as a family, changing campuses as needed for people who are in high school but don't have a car yet, wanting to be able to include the younger or older kids. How do we protect kind of generational diversity at the campuses and still have one big box for the teens?
Yeah. You know, this you're asking a question that has you guys. I know I say this all the time, but it's the right. It's a really good question, and it's very insightful. I'll say this, and I'll let Sterling speak to it. Our student ministry staff, Sterling, Tom Ward, Gretchen Gilbert, Jonathan Goble, and others have been working diligently on that very question, and think they have a plan in place to make that happen. I think I'm going to leave it to them because they have a plan for when to communicate all of that. I'd rather than say something that's half-baked here, I'm going to let them in the new year roll that all out for you. But it's exactly addressing that question.
I have a concern, and I know that this might feel awkward to you to answer.
But my concern as a mama is that you guys keep going and going and going, and you requested prayer, which is awesome. We can't do anything more powerful than that. But are there things in addition to gift cards that we can do? Because really, we want you to be at your best always. We want you to be spirit-led always. We want you to have balance between your family and sports and different things outside of church. But it appears from my seat that this is so overwhelmingly imbalanced. Do you know what I'm saying? I'm not making a judgment. I just care so much that maybe, like you gave a great suggestion, Brian, to do gift cards. Is there time off? Is there more things that can be placed for you to benefit you moving forward?
You're right. That is awkward to answer. Go ahead, Brian.
Say part of that is, part of that responsibility belongs to our executive council, our leaders here that you as a congregation elect and approve every year. There's a group from that group called the Pastoral Relations Committee. They meet with the senior pastor quarterly and they ask him those questions. Part of their job is to care for him and look for signs of stress or make sure he has taken his vacations, make sure that's part of their responsibility. Part of my responsibility is to be a support to him because I know the lay of the land. We meet quite often and he can come to me with questions and I make sure. You know, I used to tell our people, you know, when I was a leader that I used to ask them, how's your life? How's your marriage? How's your health? If I hear someday that your kids or your marriage is struggling because you're in ministry, I'll probably fire you because that stuff's important. So that's our DNA. So we take care of each other, but the executive council plus the pastoral relations committee do that. To even know you all even think about it and are here, I mean, you guys are here. There's 4,000 people who aren't here, but you guys are here already communicating care. So I've been talking while giving him a chance to think.
That's really true. You probably don't realize what showing up at a meeting like this, affirming, asking good, thoughtful questions means to me. That is, sometimes I think you think, oh, we're bothering them. That is so affirming to us. I drive home thinking people are engaged, they care, they get it. That's huge to me. As far as the balance goes, it occurs to me that perhaps when I talk about being anxious and I don't want to communicate that I don't feel like I'm shouldering this alone. I do feel like God has put a great team in place, so I don't want to give off the wrong impression there. But I'll think about it. Maybe I should take a long vacation and come back after the money's raised. That might be a good. I'll see you guys in March. Get it done. where are we? Yes.
So that's really close. As far as the name change, I don't think we ought to be too casual with that. And I guess my thoughts are I've lived in a lot of different places and have gone to a lot of different denominations. Brian, you may remember, actually I think it was Jeff that I asked you the first week we showed up of what the church's theology was.
I remember.
And he was like, whoa, nobody really asks the question about theology anymore. And I agree with the general negative connotations associated with the Baptist piece, but it also has a history of being true to the Bible and being fundamental. And it certainly, the concept of denominations to me is almost the most divisive thing in Christendom. And so it gets difficult with the name. You know, when you move to the Tri-Cities areas, well, what does that church believe? And I mean, we shopped forever, and you go and you listen, and it's like, okay, the music's good, the children's programs are good and stuff, but it's very hard to find a church that's committed to Jesus Christ, the authority of Scripture, and the things that, you know, there's the rules aspect of the Baptist church that sort of, and then teaching the doctrines of man or principles of man as the doctrines of God piece that kind of goes to extremes. Mm-hmm. But my only caution on the name change piece is we ought not lose the commitment to Jesus. And I love the things you said about but we're not giving up these things. But as you get into the name change and the brand equity, there's gives and takes. And so I can see why it's an important question. It's would be better to be recognized as being a community of churches and things that matter most. But I don't have any suggestions. I'll keep my day job. I've always failed at the the branding, the brand equity piece, but the, to me, it's really important that we identify with the authority of Scripture, the lordship of Jesus Christ, and that that's, and we want people to be drawn into that because that's what changes our lives, and we want to give them what we have and not lose in that. So I, you marketing people, good luck with the, the effort.
Dick, that is such a good reminder, and it's, I hope you hear me say, as I said before, that's a central conviction that I have and that we have, our executive council, and it's part of who we are as a church. That is not changing. We will not change our commitment to the Word of God, the gospel, even if it's culturally unpopular or that we're not doing that. I'm simply trying to, thinking about those, the name change for the reasons we talked about. So I so appreciate that reminder that as we think about this, this is not a movement away from anything that's made us who we are. Up here in the front, Pastor Bob.
I wasn't going to elaborate on this, but the reason I suggest that you go ahead and change the name is an experience that I had. I went to Oak Park, Illinois to pastor a church called Madison Street Bible Church. And after knocking on a few doors to invite people to come to the church, I began to realize that, number one, Madison Street, in their view, was Skid Row. And secondly, Bible Church was snake cult.
Snake cult?
Yes. So after 1 year, we changed the name. The church was not really growing. We changed the name to Calvary Memorial Church. And the church began to grow phenomenally. So a name change many times is a very good thing.
South Street Snake Cult Church. It's got a ring to it. That's right. Any other questions? We kept you over an hour. We're welcome. We're happy to stay here. But we have one more? Yes, Vince.
Is there any way we can pray for those that we're welcoming in to, you know, to our family? I mean, because that's kind of how I see it, as a family. And I know I've seen a lot of people stand up for Mill Creek. And is there anything that we can pray for them, you know, in this transition? Because I know that's impacting still.
Are you referring specifically to the people of Faith Baptist Mill Creek? Or just people of Mill Creek who may join us
to the,
in the future?
The people of faith that were coming from that church, I guess. So.
Yeah, I think a continued prayer for that. Because, you know, we had sort of a welcome Sunday. They had their final worship service. And many of them are finding their way here. But I don't. That's not... It's not one event and done, right? It takes time to adjust to a new church family. I guess, is there anybody here that would like to comment on that question? Yes. To your left.
For those of you who don't know me, my name is Dick Canavy. I'm a interim pastor at Faith Baptist Mill Creek. I would like to just share that for the folks that I'm close to, we have been nothing but very welcome by some great people. We are excited by programs above and beyond what we ever experienced in our small church and congregation. We're excited by the vision that's being cast, and it's just awe-inspiring for me, especially, and for some of the others that I know of, to be involved in part of the growth of God's kingdom in this area. But we do have some things, I do especially, and perhaps some others, that that God would work in our hearts and in our minds to guide us to those programs, in those groups, in those messages and lessons that He has for us as we grow and continue to mature in Christ in this area.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Well said. Okay. You started us off. You can finish us up, Bill.
When I was younger, I loved to play basketball. And I loved to play basketball in church, in the church. And I know there's a lot of people that come here Saturday morning that love to play. And is that going to be off the ticket altogether about basketball in our on our campus someplace?
Great question, and you're asking it to me because you know my history there. If and when we remodel this room, we will not have a surface on which to play basketball indoors here on our campuses. However, we would probably like to, people have been mentioning this already. Would we maybe explore a relationship with the park district facility out here, the barn, and maybe get some arrangement there? There's also nothing to say, and this is not a promise. This is something because I can't do those things anymore. But we have a lot of property here. And there's nothing that would keep us at some point in the future from putting up a simpler flat, no basement, flat slab out here if we want to. But for the time being, it won't be any of our campuses. We'll have to have an arrangement.
I agree with it. It was just, yes, agree. So the answer to your question is, as Brian said, yes, for the time being, no basketball here. But it's far cheaper to build a on-grade slab pole barn basket like, that would look nice on the outside for recreation activities for the church than it is to build a worship center. And so we think the right move fiscally and strategically is to remodel this. But I do think envision a day when that might happen out here again. But thanks for asking it. Okay, we're going to wrap things up. I'm sure some of you maybe don't like to ask in public or in a big group. Please email us or seek us out, any of us, and ask further questions and make comments. We're excited to get feedback. It really does help us shape our thinking as we move forward to hear the feedback, both the affirmations and even the questions as well. So. Is Dave Prost, Dave, is he here? Would you, I didn't ask you ahead of time, but would you close us in prayer? Dave is our church chairman, if you didn't know that.
Let's pray.
Whoa.
Father, we're so thankful for placing on the hearts of our leadership a clear vision of a significant future for FBCG. Thank you for the hearts of the leaders to see that out and to follow you, to not step in front of you, but to follow. Thank you for the hearts of our congregation who are concerned that we do this rightly and for the right reasons. As we step forward, continue to unite us in unity, clarity. Give us a vision of what that new name that would be inclusionary and not a name that perhaps turns people off. So for this group, as we go out, let us be people that follow Jesus and make him known to our neighbors and friends and invite them to our new church, our new neighborhood church. We pray this in Jesus' holy name. Amen.
Amen. Thanks, Dave. Thank all of you.